that by making a couple more simplifications in the model that I make, matrix analysis will make it possible to estimate the interactions amongst the different variables. Right? So amongst the variables that I'm being forced to estimate are the proportion of people of each age group that are seized in an African town by slave raiders, the death rate of them in the short run right there and over the long run in Africa, the proportion of males and females at each age group that are held in Africa and that are sent overseas, okay, and then death rates on board ship and plenty of other variables. So there are lots of assumptions, and you want to know if one assumption is erroneous to a certain degree, what's the effect of that going to be on all the other variables? So I just picked a couple here. If you increase the capture of children on population growth, what does that have? What is increasing the capture of children? So you capture more children. What does that do to African population overall? Or if you have a higher mortality of captives in general, what does that do to the African sex ratio? And the point is that I have a system of calculation that will enable me to say in a much simpler and more thorough way how these variables interact with one another. And it tells you which of the data on which you need the most new information. So the point is, it's good to hang around with mathematician friends. They can sometimes see simplifications in how you set up the problem that you can't see. All right, so that's setting up the problem. I now want to focus on some aspects of the work of trying to get to results. So these are the geographic regions. These are sort of conventional regions of Africa used in particular in UN statistics. And in here, I've messed with those regions to distinguish the areas of the continent from which large numbers of people were taken in captivity. So that's the middle part. So not including Southern Africa, not including Northern Africa. Northern and Southern Africa were deeply implicated in the system of slavery, but more as places into which captives were brought in rather than taken out. But each of these is a sort of a conventional zone in the literature of the time and in the available statistics on where slaves came from. And so I naturally want to estimate populations for each of these regions all the way back through the 18th and into the 17th century and compare that to the number of people estimated to have come out from there in slavery decade by decade. So now I have to come up with an African population. And when I first did this work in the 80s and 90s, I just took the colonial figures from the 1930s, which were the best they had yet, and projected them back at a growth rate assumed at 0.5% a year. And I've been wisely advised to rethink that and use the updated information. The United Nations and its demographers have been going over again and again the populations of African countries. And so their website has just a great display of information decade by decade from 1950 up to 2001 on what they've been able to put together. And the thing is that the 1950s and 60s were the time when the best censuses were done on Africa. The colonial governments didn't do a great job, and the politicization and the many pressures on African governments since the 1960s mean that censuses have been of relatively poor quality since then. So here are the figures that are now the consensus figures for the year 1951 and the year 1961. Showing the growth rate in that decade, region by region, for Africa. And of course, I'm working especially on the middle four, they're West, Central, East, and Northeast Africa. And the thing is that these population figures are much bigger than what people thought they were. What it shows is, especially in the colonial era, the colonial administration systematically underestimated the African populations. So now I have to take these populations and project them back. At what rate? Right, so these two dots over here are the 290 and 230 million for 1951 and 61. So I believe those. Okay, and so if you calculate back at as little as 0.2%, you get 200 million people in 1851. If you assume that African populations always grew at a rate of 2%, you get back to about 30 million in 1851. So this is a considerable range of uncertainty within which we're working. And furthermore, I want to say that when I did the work before, I assumed a 5% growth rate, but I also assumed much lower populations in 1930 and 40. Right? So I was down, I had populations down about here, a little over 100 million for the continent.